Okay, well, welcome everybody. I'm delighted you're all here, needless to say. Those of us who've been keeping an eye on the game will realize that there's probably more entertainment to be had in Brantford, even if I just stand here and watch you, because the result wasn't terribly good for those of us who support the local team. Anyway, I'm going to talk about, as you can see, exceptionally preserved fossils. This is a little open-ended in the sense that I can be tempted to talk for too long. And if people want to interject and ask questions, I'm very comfortable with that, so please feel free. As Deepti was saying, this is designed to be somewhat informal. And I'm not using my own computer because we couldn't get the screen to behave. Anyway, you'll be familiar, I hope, with the Peabody Museum. If you're not, please go someday. We have a wonderful exhibit which we've just put in this week of the first putative meteorite from the planet Mercury. I know one or two of you were there when we opened it the other night. This is the first opportunity to see such a meteorite, or rather part of one, anywhere in any public institution in the whole world. So we're very excited about that. And there was a great buzz on opening night. Amazing what small green objects from outer space can inspire in an audience. So it's there. And we also have this marvelous exhibit on echoes of Egypt, which is reflecting the influence of Egyptian art and architecture through the ages. That goes out early in January, so I really do exhort you to go and see it. It's really a splendid exhibit. But the outside is more familiar like this. I mean, the leaves have more or less gone now, but it was like this not very many weeks ago. And this is our famous statue, Torosaurus, which is, of course, now protecting us from the new school of management. Norman Foster's new airport terminal, which is across the street. Please don't repeat that in the company of senior administrators at Yale. Inside we have a number of newly furbished halls, but of course the ones that haven't been furbished anyway recently are the fossil halls, which are our major attraction. And we're at the stage now where the average six-year-old wanders in, says, wow, and then proceeds to dissect the exhibits and tell us what's wrong with them. They've been there since the 1940s, so one of my current tasks as the director is to try and raise, in total, some $30 million. This is a very expensive project because we have to take these fabulous specimens apart, rebuild, in a major sense, the halls themselves. But rest assured, the Zallinger mural, of course, our famous mural, will stay. It must do. It's an iconic work of art, an American icon, not just a Peabody icon. And we'll use it. My plan is to use it with a balcony on the opposite side, so we would have interactive screens where you could morph the science on the mural into what it would look like were you to paint it today. So you can use it as a way of explaining how science works, how we've progressed over time. And this, of course, is the age of reptiles. This is a very exciting PowerPoint presentation for me. Normally, the computer tells you what the next slide is. This one is not doing so. So occasionally, I'll surprise even myself. We have about 13 million specimens. I like to tell audiences, of course, that it's only approximate because I haven't quite finished counting them. And they sit now in 10 divisions. We used to have a separate division of meteorites or meteoritics. We've now combined it with mineralogy. But I think many people who come to the Peabody don't realize what extraordinary treasures we have behind the scenes. We're an amazing resource for teaching and for research. And right across the range from anthropology in all sorts of extraordinary ways, through what you'd expect in a natural history museum, but then we have, for example, quite a significant collection of historical scientific instruments. And about 60% of this material is on the main campus in New Haven, and about 40%, particularly anthropology and historical scientific instruments, but representative material from virtually every division, also at West Campus. And that's been a huge advantage to us because many of the Peabody collections, particularly anthropology, were in closets and cupboards and basements, and they're now in a much, much better situation in this new facility. So that's my day job, and it takes more time than I like to admit, but I occasionally still get a chance to do research, and I work, of course, collaboratively with people pretty much around the world, and also with the great graduate students that we can attract to Yale, which is one of the huge attractions of being there. Well, if we talk about exceptional preservation, really my concern is traces of the soft tissues. The fossil record is mostly about things like those dinosaurs. Bones, teeth, shells, the hard parts. My interest is in the soft tissues, and the soft tissues are incredibly important because actually most of the organisms on Earth don't have hard parts. So if you want to get at the history of the soft tissue or soft-bodied organisms, you have to go for these exceptional preservations. So why don't soft tissues get preserved? Well, they don't get preserved, of course, because they decay. And you can do quite a lot with fairly simple and rather elegant decay experiments. This is very simple. It's hardly elegant, but it shows you what happens if you decay a standard British polychaete, much beloved by fishermen around the coastline of the United Kingdom. Nereus, 2 days. You can see that the soft tissues have gone to fluid already. I apologize to people who've just had lunch. 6 days, it's largely compacted or flattened at least. 16 days, you can see we're left with the cuticle, the collagenous cuticle, which is the skin of the worm. And then within about 30 days, you're left with just the jaws and the bristles that give bristle worms their name. And there are many hundreds of these. I've just put a couple of them in the slide. And you can run an experiment for as long as anybody will fund you, and this will remain. But actually, these are not even what we would call hard parts because they're organic. They will decay relatively slowly, but actually oxidize and degrade in the rocks. So those kinds of worms have a pretty poor fossil record, just the occasional extraordinary occurrence. We can think about decay in another way with fossils themselves. So a sequence here of slides of the Green River. This is an Eocene, so I'm not very good at ages. I think in terms of, you know, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, which in my case is Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian. So Eocene is about 40 to 50 million years old. These are fishes from the Green River formation out west, and Priscacara conveniently decays and preserves in different conditions on the lake bed. So you can see what exceptional preservation represents. The first one, if we were to flip back, the first one gives us some information on the skin and soft tissue outline, and by the time we go through a series of degradations, you end up with this sort of thing. And the assumption, although there haven't been that many experimental tests, is that this has filled with decay gases and exploded on the lake bed, which is why you have, well, not literally bang, but you know. So you have the bones scattered on the sediment surface, and you have some little trace of the scaly outer skin, but that's essentially it. So everything decays, and getting fossilized is a pretty haphazard and rather difficult business unless you happen to have a hard skeleton. So we can think of the soft tissues then that get preserved really in two categories. On the one hand, you have those things like the jaws and bristles of that worm that are organic but resistant to decay. So let's start with those. And they make up essentially the record of fossil plants, which is almost exclusively a carbon record, and also the record of many terrestrial arthropods, creepy crawlies. This is a Devonian spider-like animal, which is one of the early types of organism that evolved on land. So not always, of course, can you extract the leaves from the rock, but occasionally you can. This is a famous locality called Clarkia out in Idaho, where you can literally degrade the rock and pull the leaves out, which is certainly very interesting. And here are some fragments of tiny bits of crustacean limbs from way back in the Cambrian, so some of the earliest many-celled organisms to evolve, and recent work by a friend of mine, Nick Butterfield, at Cambridge in England, and one of his postdocs. They've systematically started dissolving rocks of all ages, and they're turning up these little tiny fragments, cuticular fragments, particularly of arthropods. And they call this the small carbonaceous record, or the record of small organic remains. So that's one side of the equation. Those are the tissues that are pretty decay resistant, although not mineralized like bones and shells. So on the other hand, you have those parts of that worm that went to fluid in literally a matter of days. And if you want to preserve those, you have to involve very rapid early mineralization. You have to replicate them before they degrade away. It's a kind of a race between decay on the one hand and fossilization on the other. And let me show you a couple of classic examples. This is a fish, as you can see, from a Cretaceous, so somewhere in excess of 65 million years old, a deposit in Brazil. Here's a close-up of said fish. This is the kind of picture that delights those of us who used to eat fish and chips when we lived on the other side of the Atlantic, because this is the fish, and these, of course, are the ribs of that particular animal. And what's happening here is the muscle tissue, which as our simple experiment with the worm showed, goes to fluid in no time. Here the muscle tissue has survived because it's been replicated by a mineral, in this case apatite or calcium phosphate. And that mineral, if you put it under a scanning electron microscope, some localities that have this kind of preservation, not all, but some localities preserve details even of cell nuclei. So this is a cell nucleus on a series of striations and banding in the muscle. And the reason apatite or calcium phosphate is good for this is that it produces these very tiny crystallites. And it's like those, it's like the resolution of a digital photograph. If you do them, you know, just a few thousand KBs, you get a very grainy photograph, and when you blow it up, you don't see any information. In the case of apatite, because it has this very small crystallite form, these little pixels, if you like, it produces this remarkable detail. And recently, there have been reports, and I think credible, of even the preservation of neural brain tissues in some of the earliest animals back in the Cambrian. And this is the kind of information that's now coming out. There's been a couple of papers in Nature over the last 6 to 9 months of Cambrian arthropods with details of the neural tissue and the central nervous system. So that's almost unbelievable. But we've learned over time never to underestimate the fossil record. Okay, I'll talk a little bit, if you'll bear with me, about chemical fossils. I've explained that sometimes organic materials survive, sometimes you have to have minerals forming where the soft tissues would otherwise decay. If we think about ancient biomolecules, essentially the most exciting ones arguably are DNA and RNA. We'd love to be able to sequence dinosaurs, for example. But ironically, of course, chemical stability is essentially inversely proportional to the kind of useful information that you might get out of molecules. So structural biopolymers, in other words, the kinds of chemistry that forms the cuticle of the arthropods I showed you momentarily, those are chemically stable and easily preserved, whereas nucleic acids like DNA and RNA tend to break down. And although this has now become fairly routine in archaeological material, you don't really get much out of DNA beyond about 100,000 years. But never say never. I'm just waiting for that to be pushed back, and I'm sure it will happen, but it's not obvious exactly where. So it's fine when you're dealing with things like Ötzi, the famous Iceman, and indeed there's another one being found recently, but this gentleman, as you know, was up in the Tyrol between Italy and was it Austria or Germany? I forget. But, or maybe Switzerland, but there was a little bit of wrestling about whose he belonged to. You know, he was more or less on the boundary, and there was a question about which side he died on, and therefore which museum. He's ended up in Italy. So you get genome, they've got whole genomes out of this kind of material, but it's only 5,000 years old. So you can do this on very young fossil material, but not older. So if you go into deeper time, you really have to focus on more chemically resistant molecules. So let me just show you a couple of examples. This is a flying rodent from the Oligocene of Endspell in Germany, so it's about 25 million years old. When I say flying rodent, it's one of these crazy small mammals that decided to jump out of trees at an early stage in the evolution of the group and sort of went, ah! And then some of them developed fleshy extensions over considerable time through selection pressure, and you can imagine, you can do the thought experiment. You know, throw your guinea pig off the roof and you get the picture. So these things have a membrane between the appendages that allows them to glide to the ground. So they turn up occasionally in the fossil record. And this is our excavation at that locality. We weren't interested in the flying rodent, although that's what makes the locality interesting or famous. We were interested in something as mundane as the beetles. So we have a variety of techniques you can use, but if you use a mass spectrometer, you can take even very resistant materials. Mass spectrometers, using a technique which we call flash pyrolysis, essentially vaporizes the material at very high temperatures, very rapidly, and pushes them through an analytical machine, to put it simply, and gives you a sort of fingerprint. And we were looking at chitin in beetle. Chitin is the primary component in beetle cuticles, insect cuticles. It's a mixture of chitin and protein. And if you match our Endspell beetle with a trace of modern chitin, you can see that it's extraordinarily well preserved. So the preservation, at least of insect cuticles, in terms of their original chemistry, persists back probably at least about 25 million years. The material starts to modify even during decay. So this experiment runs over about 44 weeks, and I don't need to labor the point here, but suffice to say that the molecules in the shrimp begin to recombine even on that timescale. So fossilization kicks in at a very early stage indeed, and you start getting traces here which are quite different to the traces in the undecayed cuticle. So this is not just about long-term fossilization, it happens in the short term, and we can pick that up with a variety of different techniques. I shouldn't probably have put this slide in, but essentially here's the cuticle beginning to decay, and here are a number of ways of thinking about how this might be reflected in an analysis. Recently, we've been worrying about melanin. Melanin is the material that gives color to fur and feathers, but also, of course, squid ink. So if you're fond of pasta, in certain parts of the world, of course, they eat it with squid ink, which gives it that delightful black color. Obviously, nobody here has tried it by the reaction I'm getting. So this is tinta de calamar, which is essentially squid ink. And you know what squid ink is used for. It's to camouflage the animal as it escapes, and the ink sac is this black part of the squid itself. We've looked at ink sacs. Ink sacs get very readily preserved in the fossil record. Often when you find fossil squids, there's a little almost spherical or teardrop-shaped object which sits proud of the sediment and is the original ink sac. And you can you can demonstrate this in experiments as well. If you want to persuade most of your colleagues to evacuate the laboratory, you decay squids. They smell absolutely revolting at a certain stage in the process. I don't recommend you trying it at home. But what it does illustrate is that the ink sacs are highly resistant to decay. And they also have a rather good fossil record. And what you can demonstrate with a variety of techniques is not only do the little blebs of melanin survive, this is fossil melanin, which looks essentially very similar to the melanin of a living squid, but also the chemistry tends to survive. And we've used this method of vaporizing the material to analyze it. And again, here you see fossil squid ink sacs, just the ink sac. No, the rest of the squid's gone. You're just left with the ink sac for the most part. And then here's a standard. This is what we do. We take melanin, squid ink, and analyze it, and it looks like this. And if we look at fossil squids back to the Jurassic, so squids of significant age, hundreds of millions of years, the squid is essentially, the ink is essentially unmodified. So it's one of these very, very resistant, long-surviving molecules. If you go to rocks that have been heated, metamorphosed to a degree, buried to some depth, you find that the squid ink is beginning to alter, and you're beginning to get those kinds of products that you get in other kinds of organic material as they alter through time. And eventually these things are turning into kerogen, which is the source of hydrocarbons or oil. So it all leads ultimately.
That picture of the melanin?
Yes.
The lower one is how old compared to the...
They're both Jurassic. Okay. So melanin, squid ink behaves in an odd way. Depending on temperature, it tends to form granules of slightly different sizes. And that occurs in living squids as well as in fossil ones. So we were interested in melanin because, of course, it's the key to color. And years ago, melanin was discovered, specifically melanosomes, which are the little organelles that contain the melanin. And these are melanosomes in the fur of a bat from Messel. And Messel is Eocene, so it's about 50 million years old. And when this was first described back in the 1980s by a good friend of mine, Michael Wuttke in Germany, he interpreted these not as melanosomes, but as bacteria. And the hunch was, these are bacteria colonizing the surface of the fur on the bat, and for some reason, getting preserved. Well, it turns out that one of my graduate students had an epiphany a few years ago, Jakob Winter, and said, hey, maybe these structures are actually melanin. So how would we test this? Well, we decided we would start testing it by looking at feathers. This is a fossil feather, about 70 million years old, which has clear banding. And this is real because you can see it has the same kind of bleeding into other parts of the feather that you see in modern feathers. And of course, if this is melanin, you'd expect those structures to be just in the dark areas. But if they're bacteria, there's no reason why bacteria should prefer to eat the black parts of a feather than the white parts, because they'd be after the keratin. So you'd expect the whole thing to be covered in bacteria. And in practice, of course, these structures are only where the dark parts are. So here's our living example. You tear the feather, there are the melanosomes. Here's the fossil example. Here, indeed, are the melanosomes. So they're essentially the same. In this case, some of the other components of the feather, the keratin is still there. It's decayed here, so you see the melanosome slightly more clearly. But you can see in the white areas, here there are no melanosomes. Here there's just an indication of the sediment that the feather's been buried in. So we have melanosomes, and what can we do with melanosomes? Well, having done the black and white feather, we then thought we'd look at feathers that look colored as fossils. Now that's kind of odd. This can't be the original color, but there are feathers, again from Messel, that look colored. So this is a real color picture, as it were. If you look at the melanosomes in this feather under the scanning electron microscope, these are pictures. And what these are showing is that the outer surface of the feather has a layer of very close packed melanosomes. And these melanosomes actually generate not just a chemical color, but a structural color, in that they form a very thin layer off which the light bounces. And what you're actually seeing is evidence of iridescence. So this same kind of phenomenon produces these extraordinary effects. I'm not talking about the color, but the way it iridesces. So we know that we had iridescence in this fossil feather.
Can you show the previous slide again, please?
Of course. Well, maybe. There it is.
Wow.
Okay. So, of course, even scientists are susceptible to the notion that it might be interesting to get the public excited in what they do. So the obvious way to go, having discovered that we could at least demonstrate that melanosomes were preserved in fossil feathers, and that they could indicate at least iridescence, was could we reconstruct the color of fossil feathers? And why go to birds when you could go to dinosaurs? So this is the old reconstruction of Deinonychus. Deinonychus is a Peabody dinosaur. It's in there in all its glory, except, of course, the Peabody example doesn't have feathers. This is how we would reconstruct Deinonychus now. These delightfully cuddly-looking animals, of course, are ripping apart this unfortunate Tenontosaurus. But the colors you see, or saw rather, in books like this, this is a book by John Long and Peter Shouten, published not very many years ago, actually. These are entirely fictional. This is a comparison with the Argus pheasant, which you may be familiar with, which has this extraordinary patterning on the feathers and uses them in this amazing mating display. And this is simply being put on a dinosaur with no evidence whatsoever. And that's the nature of that reconstruction, or indeed this previous one. So a number of groups, ourselves at Yale and a group at Bristol, started applying this notion of melanosomes to coloring dinosaurs at about the same time. This is Sinoceropteryx, which has circular melanosomes. And those of you who have or had ginger hair will have had melanosomes of this shape. We know that circular melanosomes tend to be brown, russet, orange in color. So this thing was reconstructed, and I don't have the reconstruction on a slide, but it was reconstructed as a kind of orangey brown feathered creature. Our animal was this thing, Anchiornis. We had great fun wandering around China trying to get skeletons and feathered specimens that we could sample. The Chinese are extraordinarily polite. And one of the drawbacks with that is that they have great difficulty in saying no. So we went to a number of institutions where it was quite clear that they were already in collaborations or had notions they might do some of this work themselves. And instead of saying, I'm sorry, guys, we can't work with you on this stuff, you should perhaps go and talk to Dr. X, they simply go on vacation or visit their mother or are out to lunch on the day in question. Which is kind of frustrating, but that's their, essentially, they don't like to be impolite, so they don't like to say, I'm sorry, we can't do this. Anyway, we eventually got into a collaboration with the National Museum in Beijing. We got this wonderful specimen, and Jakob and I sampled all round the feathers on this animal and found that the melanosomes were somewhat different. And the work on living feathers was catching up at the same time. People were able to demonstrate that a combination of factors like size and shape and packing were characteristic of different colors, and at least we could do browns, grays, whites, and reds because of these spherical ones, different colors in living birds. And I'm not sure whether this reconstruction is here. It's not, so it's up there. I'm obviously being very modest today. This is our reconstruction of Anchiornis, which is the first full plumage color reconstruction of a dinosaur based on real data ever. And happily for us, of course, it had these little spherical melanosomes in the crest. So we were able to, otherwise it was just a big fluffy chicken. So it turned out to be a big fluffy chicken with a magnificent red crest, which of course meant we could commission this spectacular reconstruction, which, we all know a picture tells 1,000 words. And it managed to get into, I forget now, Science or Nature, probably on the strength of the fluffy chicken as much as anything else.
Aren't most animals red blind? I thought primates were the only ones who really see the color.
That's a good question. I'm not entirely sure what the correct answer is. Maybe somebody else knows. Are birds red blind? I doubt it.
Most birds have good color.
Yeah. But I think you're right in terms of some primates. That's absolutely true. But I think birds are able to do this. But otherwise, we'd... yeah. But thank you. This is not a straightforward issue. You're quite right. So, of course, we then started worrying about whether these things could get destroyed or distorted in fossils. And we did some experiments with another of my postdocs, a young woman called Maria McNamara. This is a bluebird feather. This is what the melanosomes in a fresh bluebird feather looks like. If you subject a bluebird feather to 250 degrees centigrade under pressure for a period of time, it sort of melts and the melanosomes begin to degrade and change size and shape, which is what we were worried about. So it's quite clear to do these sorts of reconstructions, we really need to focus on feathers that haven't been, that aren't in rocks that have been buried to some depth and therefore cooked. And this is a series of experiments showing how you can destroy the feather and even the color, rather, and even the patterns at certain temperatures and pressures. So we need to understand the context of our fossil deposit in terms of interpreting the feather. So in terms of the other part of my lecture, having talked a little bit about the nature of soft tissue preservation and some of the things you can do with it and the problems of chemistry and the preservation of chemistry, I want to talk a little bit about exceptional preservations in general. The Germans have a term for it called Lagerstätte or Lagerstätten in plural. It simply means a kind of mother load or bonanza. So you can see there's a huge concentration of these in the Cambrian, and the one I worked on as a graduate student was indeed the Burgess Shale, made famous by Steve Gould in his 1989 book, Wonderful Life. But I've now started focusing in some detail on later exceptional preservations from the Ordovician and Silurian. And it turns out that the big explosion, the so-called Cambrian explosion, of course, is a Cambrian phenomenon. So that's when all the major groups appear and many, what we ill-advisedly would call experimental forms as well. But if we want to understand the origins of modern groups, we need really to go to younger rocks. And then we have the problem that due to a variety of factors, we don't have quite so many examples as we have in the Cambrian, where there's a superabundance. So at the moment, I have a major project with one of my postdocs, a man called Peter Van Roy, and we're also collaborating with a group in Europe, mainly based in France, in Ordovician rocks. So these are these rocks. Let me just return briefly to this. So this is here. So it's in the lower Ordovician of Morocco. And I'll talk a little bit in a moment or two about Beecher's Bed, which is in the upper Ordovician of New York State. The lower Ordovician of Morocco is the one of particular interest initially. So our locality, or the city, I suppose we can glorify it with the term city, that we essentially base ourselves in is Zagora, which is south of the Atlas Mountains. So to sort of focus you in, Marrakesh, Fez, Rabat, Casablanca, these are the resorts up on the coast. So you drive across the Atlas Mountains to Zagora, and all these red crosses indicate localities where we found exceptionally preserved fossils. So usually these things are fairly unusual and rather rare, but it just happens that in this lower Ordovician unit in Morocco, there are many, many localities over a very significant area. So this is what it looks like. Our famous meteorite from Mercury is prefixed NWA, which means Northwest Africa. And it was also found in Morocco. And you can see why. I mean, there are two things going on. One is there are rocks everywhere, but there's very little vegetation. So things are not concealed in the way they are over most of Connecticut, for example. This is why we only find meteorites in Connecticut when they happen to make a blinding flash in the sky and fall through somebody's roof. If they disappear into the forest behind your house, nobody's ever going to find them. In Morocco, you have indigenous peoples who live in the desert, who have developed over the last couple of decades a very tidy sideline in fossils particularly, but also meteorites. And they get very highly skilled in spotting odd things on the desert floor. So this is great. And it works well for us because the outcrop is very close to the surface, so you can make shallow excavations and pick up, as we've done here, a series. This is the same bed outcropping on a series of little spurs across this hillside, and you can see the outcrop is very close to the surface. Now, I would be exaggerating if I were to say that we go out and collect fossils here. We do some of that, but we also work very closely with local collectors who work literally all year round, and we have one particular gentleman who's highly skilled at this, and The important thing for us is that he retains locality information. So the postdoc I'm working with, who's a Belgian, goes back from time to time and then goes into the field with this gentleman and learns where the specific fossils he's collected have come from, and then we do a little bit of negotiation. And I could fill my storage space at West Campus several times over every year if I had space, one, or could afford to do it, two. But we've a lot of splendid material from these several levels. This is Moroccan, you know, dress style. As you can see, this is Jacob Winter and Peter Van Roy, my colleague. They figured out very quickly how to tie these marvelous blue scarves. I never quite worked it out, so I always had to resort to the more conventional headgear. It doesn't look quite as stylish in the photographs, but it works fine, believe me. So we're turning up fossils here of all sorts and shapes. This is a rather esoteric example, but this is an animal called a macaridian. It was known for about 150 years and turns up in reasonable quantities in all sorts of limestones around the world in Paleozoic rocks, but normally as isolated plates, little plates like this. And people have wrestled with it. They thought they were bits of echinoderms, relatives of sea urchins. They thought they were barnacle plates. They thought they were bits of worms. And it turns out this thing is indeed a worm, because the Ordovician rocks yielded here the plates in situ, but also the body of the thing, early mineralized with bristles, just like the ones that were yielded by that decay experiment of mine that I showed you early in the presentation. So this resolved a mystery, which you clearly weren't lying awake worrying about, but some of us were, that had persisted for some 150 years. And I mention it simply to say that this is the kind of extraordinary preservation and very rare preservation. Here's a model of this thing, just to show you. It's an armored worm. And we've now turned up a number of other armored worms. But some of the other fossils are really quite amazing. This would qualify as the earliest, well, you can see what it is. It's a horseshoe crab. So this pushed back the fossil record of horseshoe crabs about 40 million years. This remarkable preservation. Look at this extraordinary animal. This is an extinct group of arthropods with these fabulous spiny covering all over the surface of it. This is another arthropod, a sort of shrimp-like thing with a strange carapace which consists of these two forks, if you like. It's known as furca, is its scientific name, and the two forks have these series of spines all around them. And that's a Cambrian example of the same sort of animal, a thing called Morella from my favorite Burgess shale. So this Moroccan discovery showed that many of these strange Cambrian animals, which we thought had gone extinct back in the Middle Cambrian, persist for another 40, 50 million years into the early Ordovician. It's just a question of finding the right kind of rocks to preserve them. And this is perhaps our most celebrated example. We found examples of these giant predators, again, which occur in the Cambrian, and we thought it had gone extinct in this Ordovician locality. But the odd thing about the Ordovician ones is they're more or less complete. So these are huge concretions. We have them out at West Campus, and they're literally this kind of size. And my wonderful Belgian postdoc has this sense that he wants to restore it in its entirety, and he's pretty much succeeded. This is what the appendages look like. The appendages don't turn up in the concretions, they turn up in the shales alongside. I'll get to the reconstruction in a minute so you'll have a sense of what it looks like. Here's one of Peter's examples at West Campus. This is the one we're working at the moment. Now, anybody who had any practical sense, he's a genius, this guy. But really, if you want to work with, this is a tons, it's extraordinarily heavy. It would be much easier to move around if he left it in bits. And then, of course, nowadays you can use very elegant methods of taking pictures and stitching the photographs together to produce a complete specimen. He, however, is determined that the whole thing shall be in one piece, and then we're going to have the greatest fun moving it around, as you can probably imagine. So this is where we are with this. But this is essentially what this animal looks like. So it's about half a meter long, at least. It has this remarkable set of grasping appendages at the front, pair of lateral eyes, and then a series of body divisions which have gill-like structures, which were almost certainly for respiration, for oxygen exchange, on the dorsal surface. So it's a really bizarre thing, which would look perfectly at home in the Cambrian, but is a very extraordinary discovery in the Ordovician, in these much younger rocks. And we have something like this in even younger rocks, in Devonian rocks in Germany, but here this is morphing into a more ordinary arthropod. So the back end of this is like a regular marine shrimp sort of thing, but the front end still has these huge eyes and these strange appendages. So again, this is an example of how these remarkable preservations are critical to tracking these very strange animals about which we would otherwise know nothing. Okay, I'm watching the clock. You probably are as well by now, but anyway. Let me take you nearer home, Upper New York State, Beecher's trilobite bed. Beecher was one of my predecessors as certainly curator of invertebrate fossils at the Peabody Museum, and I think he was probably director for a while as well. And he worked this locality in Upper New York State back in the 1890s and wrote many papers on the trilobites particularly, and then the locality was lost because the ground degrades very quickly. It was rediscovered back in the late 1980s, and I got involved at that stage, even though I was still working at the University of Bristol in England, because I was interested in how these things are preserved. And then my first unfortunate graduate student, when I came to Yale just over 10 years ago, I put on this project. This was a young woman from Ireland who she finished, and she did a fabulous job, but this was an extremely difficult piece of work, because working in black rocks with very rare fossils in a complicated problem, it's not fun. She had tremendous tenacity. She's now working as a collection manager in the University of Kansas. So we did a pretty sizable excavation. The local landowner loves to drive these large excavating machines. The fact that he is legally blind was something of a concern. He has peripheral vision. He's not allowed to drive a car on the road, but he could, you know, pick up tennis ball-sized things with this kind of machine without any trouble at all. But you did keep well clear of the bucket when he was doing his stuff. This is our work back in 1989. This was long before I came to Yale. We took a column like this and cut it into blocks and sent it back and analyzed the chemistry through each layer to try and figure out why the fossils were preserved. And this is our distribution now. Originally, it was just that one Beecher's discovery. We now have another discovery locally, which was made in 2008. And then about 60 miles further north at Lowville, we have a very talented, I hesitate to call these guys amateurs. He's anything but amateur. He's a brilliant collector who's discovered another locality with this same kind of preservation some distance away. So what it shows you is, if you stripped all the vegetation off New York State, it'd be like going to Morocco in terms of where the fossils might be found. It's just we're hampered by the overburden. I'll skip that because you're... So this is what the fossils look like. So they're unusual. And if you know trilobites at all, you'll know that this is the sort of standard morphology. There are only a handful of localities worldwide where you get the soft tissue. So you can see the antennae, the limbs out of the side. Here's a view from the underside with details of the appendages. So this is why Beecher was so excited about this thing. And these are some of the specimens from Marcus Martin's quarry much further north. And again, you can see spectacular examples with beautiful appendages. And he's preserving these, he's preparing these with a little sandblaster, which uses a soft powder that's tough enough to remove the shale, but not tough enough to damage the pyrite. And if you do it under a microscope, you can produce spectacular details. Back in the day, Beecher did the same thing with ink erasers. So he would rub away very gently with an ink eraser and do it that way. And they often set the specimens in plaster Paris or something to consolidate them, keep them together while they were doing this sort of work. So it was quite challenging. We've recently been working on very tiny little shrimp-like things. They're just millimeters long, which are the earliest example of an important group called ostracods. And these things, in some cases, even preserve the eggs. So this is pretty unusual stuff. And all this in this case, in iron pyrite. Okay, then one final example in the last 5 minutes or so, and then I'll open for questions should there be any. Moving up into the Silurian, so we've talked about two Ordovician localities, one in Morocco, one in Upper New York State. And then I've also been working for 20 years or more with a group of English colleagues at a locality in Herefordshire in England. This is on the borderland between England and Wales. And this, unusually, compared to Morocco and Beecher's Bed in Upper New York State, is still a unique locality. We haven't found anywhere else in the world where fossils are preserved in the same way. And I think that has to be because people aren't looking. And the reason people aren't looking, by and large, is because, as you'll see in a moment or two, these are not the kind of fossils you'd put on your mantel shelf or in your display cabinet. So there's no incentive for the amateur community, the collectors, to go and look for this stuff because it's just too difficult to work with. So the professionals are too busy running museums and, you know, going to Brantford in the afternoon to talk to delightful people like you and are not spending time looking for fossils. So that's essentially what's going on. But the earth-moving equipment is, again, de rigueur. This is what these things look like when you find them in the field. Geological hammer for scale. So everything from just under golf ball size to small grapefruit. Appeals enormously to an Irishman like me because it's just like picking potatoes up in a field. But we've no idea what's inside them until we get them back to the lab and split them. And the fossils, as we'll see, are very tiny indeed. Bentonite is a word, a technical term for volcanic ash. And these things are millimeter in dimension, or, you know, a few millimeters long. They're the victim of ash dumped in the sea, volcanic ash dumped in the sea, and probably reworked. I don't think they were, you know, it wasn't a Tuesday afternoon thing where there was a volcanic explosion and they all perished. They may well have been buried by moving sediment, which was originally ash. The first one we looked at, described, was this animal here. Now, you have to bear in mind that this is about, it's less than an inch long. It's about, I would guess, 10, 15 millimeters. I've broken one of those concretions, and I'm using the word I in a sort of royal sense. One has broken one of these concretions and revealed this, which is essentially holes, original holes in this little sphere of volcanic ash, carbonate cemented volcanic ash. And the holes are where the animal was, and the holes have been infilled with calcite, a mineral, which looks black because of the way it's broken and the light impacts it. So there's some indication now that we might be able to get at these using sophisticated synchrotron methods. But for the last 20 years, we've used the only method possible. You can't prepare these mechanically. You can't dissolve them out of the rock, because if you dissolve the concretions, the fossils dissolve as well. So we've used the time-honored method of serial sectioning. Now, the old days, they would have sliced the rock and stacked the slices. What we now do, and again, I'm using we very loosely here, what we now do is mount little chips in this apparatus here, rotate it round on a very smooth plate with a grinding powder, and you literally take off 30 or 40 microns, I mean, a precise thickness every time. You wash it, one washes it, photographs it, grinds away another 40 microns, washes it, photographs, and so on. So very time-consuming. Here she is, Carolyn Lewis, who's our present... whoops. Oh, this doesn't look good, does it? Who's our present person. Hang on, we'll just see what happens if I... Okay. Can you help me, Deep? What it's doing now is showing me different parts of the same illustration. Even if this goes pear-shaped, I've talked about most of what I was going to talk about, so it won't be the end of the world. Well, it never is anyway, is it? What happens if you try starting from current slide? Oh, maybe it's there, is that? Yeah. It's not very different from when you section tissues. No, you're absolutely right. Except in that case, you retain what you section. In this case, it's destructive. So the fossil is destroyed. I mean, one of the objections museum people have is, well, you've described this specimen. It may be unique. But you've nothing left for anybody else to look at. It's gone. This is, you know, something that one simply doesn't do. You always have to have the voucher specimen. The answer is you have the voucher specimen as a series of slices on a CD, which you can send to 100 people if you want to.
Just finish saving. You might be able to.
Yeah, it might. So see if it'll. Can you come out of it and go back in? Ah, well.
You
want to go. Yeah, now go forward one. Okay, we're back on track. Let's keep our fingers. Keep your collective fingers crossed, please. Okay. So this definitely won't work. Had we managed to get this working on my computer, I would have been able to rotate this for you in glorious Technicolor, and you would have been able to see the reconstruction of the animal. But you get the idea. The colors, of course, are totally false. There's interpretation overlaid. But this is the result of combining those many, many slices, stacking them up with a computer program and producing. Well, this is a standard technique now in medicine and all sorts of other disciplines. So here's our latest one. This is what it looks like when the rock is broken and you just have a slice. We have great fun trying to guess what these things are, and we almost always get it wrong. But this thing turns out to be a little early horseshoe crab. But the neat thing about this is that in contrast to the horseshoe crabs you collect or find on the seashore, which have, as you probably know, a pair of little claws and then a series of six limbs and a seventh, which is kind of small and called the chilarium. Our animal has too many, a surfeit of these things. And what in essence happens is you have an anterior limb which has just a little tiny claw on the end of a much longer appendage than you might expect, and then subsequently these single limbs in modern limulus have two branches. Now, two branches is not unusual in any kind of arthropod, but what's very odd about these things is that the two branches are not joined at the base, but insert in different places on the body wall of the ancient horseshoe crab. So you can do the matching up. So here's one and one, but two, of course, has two branches, and three has two branches, and four has two branches, and likewise five. Six has only one. So we hypothesize that this is a stage in the evolution of a more modern-looking horseshoe crab, which involved the loss of one of these branches to give the single one that you see in the modern example. And then the question is there any clue that this might have happened in evolutionary terms? And one of the interesting developments recently has been a return to old-fashioned embryology, in a sense, but with staining, so that people can do the evolutionary development. This is a very early embryo of a modern horseshoe crab, stained with stained to reveal distalis, which is one of the genes. It doesn't totally control limbs, but it's part of the limb story. And you can see these little dark spots. Take my word for it. The arrows are very helpful. Little dark spots. This is where you get a brief expression of this gene, which is gone by the next stage in the development of the animal. And this is precisely where those lost branches are present in the fossil. So they perhaps give us a hint of what's going on.
Is there a missing spot for where six would have been?
There is. I'm not sure I would attach huge significance to that, but yes, that does appear to be. That's almost too convenient. So this is our array of creatures from this Silurian biota in England. This is about 20 years of work, and you can see a variety of different creatures. This is a sea spider. It's about one of the very few sea spiders in the fossil record. This is our arthropod that we've seen. We've got various kinds of plated slug-like things. We've got snails. We've got worms. We have little shrimps. And so it goes on. So it's proved very exciting. And most of these have been based on one or two specimens. They're so wonderfully preserved that you can get most of the information out of just a very few. This is the one we've just submitted. It's struggling through some journal or other. And finally, in 1 minute, this is not my work, but I just throw this in. It's something that I wrote a commentary on in the last few weeks. I said at one point during the presentation that we should never underestimate the fossil record. This is a mosquito from a relatively new locality in Montana. It's Eocene, so it's about 45 to 50 million years old. And this specimen is a blood-engorged mosquito. So this is something that's had its meal, has had a postprandial accident, and ended up on the lake bed with all the rest. And what essentially happens in this biota, I mean, we're imagining this is the only mammal known from this locality so far, so we used that as our little reconstruction. It probably bit its ear because it would have been naked there. Sank to the bottom. All the other insects get eaten up by fish, but for some reason, which I can't fully explain, these little tiny mosquitoes get through, and one of them just happens to have been a blood meal. And a group down in the Smithsonian used a new technique called Tof Sims to show not only was there a spike in the iron, which you can use other techniques to show, because of course hemoglobin, which is in the blood, will have a lot of iron, but also the heme molecule survives, and you can show that that's still present.
Is it the same size as a modern day mosquito?
Yeah, it's pretty much that same size, yes. So this is essentially what happens. You fossilize your blood-engorged mosquito. Your hemoglobin degrades, so the proteins go, but the heme survives, and the heme is slightly modified, but only slightly. So you can do the thought experiment and imagine the chances of that actually happening, one, and two, having some evidence of the original blood materials. So I'm never surprised. All sorts of extraordinary things come out of the record, and you just have to wait till next week and something else will turn up. Anyway, thank you folks for your attention. So I'm in your hands. What's the procedure, DP? I'm very happy to see people depart or ask. Okay, so, and we can do this, you know, if people need to go, please do. And if you want to ask questions, please do. Or you want to hang around afterwards, we can talk about anything. The mosquito is Eocene, so I'm going to guess it's 50 million years-ish. Yeah. Yes, madam. That's one of those. Well, I can't give you a rigorous answer to that. Partly pure chance, I would guess, but probably because if one tried to address it seriously, they're generalists. They're pretty tolerant of fairly unpleasant conditions, so they're going to be, you know, resistant to reasonable changes. They're not very specialized. So when the environment changes, it often doesn't affect them too dramatically because they're used to coping with a variety of different circumstances. But that's about the best answer I can give you. It's not a very good one, but they have a hugely long fossil record. I mean, they really are, you know, we don't like to talk about living. I'm sorry?
Would you
Yeah, I mean, people are obviously concerned that they're diminishing seriously. And I believe they still capture and bleed them and they harvest them for the chitin, which they use in various pharmaceuticals. So they're a resource which is still overexploited, like so many things these days.
What's the mammal that was bitten by this mosquito?
It's a little primate of some kind, an omomyid, I think. So it's been described from this Eocene locality. and there are examples from a number of others as well. But, you know, I just, for my little cartoon, I just chose one thing that was described from here that might conceivably have been there. But there could have been, no doubt, lots of other things that, that you know, better fit the bill.
I don't want to hog the question.
I have a question about the limestone. So the shape was dictated by color?
No. The melanosomes impart color. The correlation is not very well understood. I mean, when we started doing this work, we collaborated with a group, a man called Matt Shawkey, who's at the University of Akron in Ohio, who's one of the pioneers in looking at the diversity of packing shape and size in melanosomes in different bird feathers of different colors. So he produced a large database which he could plot, you know, using principal components in three dimensions, so that we could put our feathers into his box of data. And then with some reasonable statistical inference, you could say, well, it's probably in the gray or the black or the white or the, but it doesn't do other pigments. So it's a very imprecise, if we are honest about it. It's more rigorous than anything that's gone before, but it has a long way to go. And then, as I was showing, we do worry about whether fossilization can alter the shape and size of these things, in which case the color predictions could well be compromised.
Did you come across other problems, such as mitochondria?
No, no. I think melanin, for whatever reason, seems to be one of the most durable molecules out there. I mean, we found one or two other things. I mean, we're always interested in chemical preservation, and melanin, for whatever reason, is something that is very resistant. And obviously, there are lots of people who look at it for other reasons that go way beyond fossils and have similar kinds of inferences. Yep? It's not helpful for classification per se, but it does, I mean, we've done it with insects and birds, and obviously the ecologists get very excited because color is about display and about camouflage and about sexual signaling and so forth. So those kinds of ecological inferences are the one thing that would be great. I mean, Rick Prum, my brilliant ornithological colleague at Yale.
Who's going to come and speak to us?
Oh, is he?
Yeah.
And that will be good, so don't miss it. But he has this vision of doing a kind of field guide to feathered dinosaurs, where you could basically paint them up. I mean, that's a little bit out in the future, but I mean, feasible, I think, eventually, yes. If you've got enough well-preserved feathered dinosaurs, you could potentially do that. Not that it'd be much use to anybody, but it would be exciting to do.
There's
a long lady here.
What's your favorite part about working with fossils?
What's my favorite part
with them? Could you repeat the question?
The question was, it's one of those impossible questions. What's your favorite part about working with fossils? I think there's nothing to beat, and I don't get much chance to do it now, just that, it sounds corny, that thrill of discovery. I mean, I remember doing Burgess work in the Canadian Rockies too many years ago now. And what you do there, if you want to find fossils initially, is you don't try and beat the hell out of the cliff face. You look at the scree, because the stuff has spalled off the mountain and it's sitting on the hillside, and you can walk across it. And we did some of this work on scree that nobody had ever walked on before. We were helicoptered in, and then you go to places where nobody's ever been. And these things are just there, and it's incredibly exciting. I mean, it's like the sort of equivalent of the Easter egg hunt or, the first visit to Toys R Us or whatever. I mean, there's nothing, you can't beat it. And the funniest thing was, I was working with a guy who worked on fossil echinoderms, so relatives of starfishes and sea urchins, and he found all the echinoderms, and I, because I worked on arthropods, found all the arthropods. And it's because you don't know it, but you have a search image in your mind, and you spot shapes that you're trained in some way to see. So he was seeing them, and I was seeing these other things, and it was just, so it's that kind of wow, And it's when the light bulb goes off as well in the lab, and you think, well, why don't we try that and see if it'll work? Yeah. Okay, maybe that's a good place to stop.
Well, I have two questions.
Okay.
One is, Are there any examples where Cambrian as well as other period fossils are found in the same place?
Well, they obviously won't be found in the same rocks, but in terms of the same sequence, no. I mean, there's no continuous sequence from Cambrian into Ordovician where you get exceptionally preserved fossils in both. There are certainly continuous sequences from Cambrian into Ordovician, but they would be tracked by shelly fossils. So you need a particular set of circumstances to get the kinds of preservations I've been talking about, and they're not all that common, although they're far more common than people used to realize. That's one question.
Yeah, my second question is, all that wonderful stuff that is going on in your lab,
yeah.
How does one get to see it? Can you come to your lab?
You could bring the group and look at the collections behind the scenes, sure. Okay. We could work that out for you. Yeah, I mean, it's easier to do during the week because the collections people are always, they're there.
Yeah.
So if we have a group, it's very easy to do that. If we do it at a weekend, I've got to bring them in. But yeah, we could do that because we could bring a few in and show you some stuff. That would be a different kind of cafe. You'd have to move from Brantford rather than bring your speaker here. But sure, sure, yeah. Oh, sure. I mean, there are marvelous dinosaur footprints, dinosaur remains. I mean, we're part of this dinosaur trail that includes, what's it, Rock Creek, what's it called? I'm blanking now. The Connecticut Dinosaur Museum up I-91.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but Connecticut's not a mecca for exceptional preservations.
Right.
No. Yeah, there's a huge concentration of exceptional preservations in Germany, which I always thought was terribly unfair, but that's... Yeah, but that's just chance. That's just chance.
There's quite a bit of them in the Syracuse area.
There are some splendid localities in Syracuse, you're right, yes. Yes, indeed. We used to take trips up there, the Finger Lakes. Yeah. Yeah.
So
okay.
On that note, I'd like to thank you again. Sure. And for those who are...